Okay, welcome everybody. I'm Mac Owens, I'm the Dean of Academics here at IWP. For those of you who are not familiar with us, we are a small, independent graduate school, national security affairs, and we welcome you here. One of the cool things about being the Dean is I get to invite my friends to speak, and Bob is a good friend of mine. He has the misfortune of teaching in Malibu, California, at Pepperdine University, where he's the Robert and Catherine Doxon Professor of Public Policy in the School of Public Policy there. He has a PhD from Columbia, and feeling that he's undereducated with a PhD, also has a JD from Georgetown. He's the author of four books, and he'll be talking about his most recent one here today. He wrote a biography of Senator Henry Jackson. He wrote about arms control before the nuclear age. And he wrote a book that made himself very popular, which was in defense of the Bush Doctrine. Today's book is Dangerous Doctrine, How Obama's Grand Strategy Weakened America, which he argues that instead of sort of the popular view that we have many times that this president's kind of feckless, that in fact he has a very clear view of what he wants to do, and he's doing it. And he, of course, Bob's argument is this is a rather dangerous approach. So, please help me welcome Bob Kaufman.
Good morning. Thanks, Mac, for the kind introduction. I'm honored to be here, and I'm going to talk today about my recently released book called Dangerous Doctrine. As Mac mentioned in the introduction, for a long time on both sides of the political spectrum, the consensus was that President Obama did not operate based on a clearly defined set of principles. He was, to quote an admirer of Fareed Zakaria, a pragmatist. Will Inboden, who was a critic, also believed that Obama basically responded to events rather than pursued a well-defined agenda. I think that's inaccurate, and I think now the consensus is that President Obama does have a well-defined doctrine that he has pursued with remarkable fidelity despite the vagaries of politics. In one way, President Obama is very similar to Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher. Both are conviction rather than consensus politicians, meaning that all three of these statesmen seek to transform the political agenda. President Obama has sought assiduously literally to rewrite the American social contract, the relationship between government and the individual. What's less understood, but I think is equally an ambition of President Obama, is to rewrite the American relationship with the world. Let me get to the essence and then I'll elaborate. President Obama's doctrine repudiates the tradition of robust internationalism that I believe reached its most successful apotheosis under Harry Truman and Ronald Reagan. He has repudiated that in favor of a devolution of American power, underlied by the assumption of his that the greatest threat to the world is not the enemies we have, but American power itself. So let me elaborate on what I call the main tenets of the Obama Doctrine. Then I will show how the Obama Doctrine has significantly weakened us and operated in the three major geopolitical regions of the world, Europe, the Middle East, and East Asia. And in the final part of the talk, I will lay out my alternative to Obama's doctrine, what I call neo-Reaganism adapted to the conditions of the 21st century. Also, with my propensity to qualify for the Witness Protection Program, I will also make some intimation of why, if you are a neo-Reaganite, Donald Trump is not the ideal candidate for you, to say the least. So let me start with what the main tenets of the Obama Doctrine are. I laid this out in the book, but I'm going to focus not on all seven, but just a few of them as foundational. And as my point of departure, again, I think the contrast between Reagan and Obama is very instructive. If you read Obama's sort of quasi-memoir, part fact, part fiction, The Audacity of Hope, named after a sermon given by his pastor, Jeremiah Wright, Obama defines himself politically as the veritable anti-Reagan. That's true. That's also true in terms of temperament and instinct. Consider this. Ronald Reagan considered himself an ordinary man leading an extraordinary, exceptional nation. Reagan was half right. The nation was exceptional, and so was Reagan. President Obama is exactly the opposite. He believes that he is literally a world historical figure in a Hegelian sense, an extraordinary man leading a badly flawed group of people who can learn more by the UN Charter and the operation of the United Nations than the world can learn from the Declaration of Independence and the most successful social experiment in history. The foundational principle of the Obama Doctrine, from which all else flows, again showing he is the veritable anti-Reagan, is that Obama believes and has applied consistently the principle that the greatest threats to the United States don't come from our external enemies or rogue regimes seeking to destroy us, not just for what we do, but who we are. For Obama, the greatest threat to America's interests, rightly understood, or as he understands it, is what J. William Fulbright in the 1960s famously, and in my view infamously, called the arrogance of American power. What the world needs, according to President Obama, is not American protection from tyranny. The world needs protection from American power. So several corollary premises flow from this. One, Obama is an exponent of multilateralism as the default position for how the United States operates in the world. Except for a very rare and very narrow set of circumstances, President Obama believes that international institutions such as the United Nations constitute the arbiter of legitimacy for when and how the United States uses force abroad. Well, think about the implications of that. Think about the structure of the United Nations Security Council, which is an example of what Samuel Johnson called a second marriage, a triumph of hope over experience. The UN Security Council, the main body of the United Nations that determines national security questions or international security questions, has 15 members, five of whom are permanent. Each of the five permanent members have a veto. So think about what that really means. For the United States to make the United Nations the arbiter of international legitimacy, as President Obama has done in his terribly ill-advised Iranian nuclear deal that puts Iran on the Autobahn of crossing the nuclear threshold, even if theoretically we could detect Iranian violations, which we can't reliably, because the agreement gives Iran the right to determine the number and scope of inspections, but even in the rare case we discern a violation, theoretically the agreement says there will be a snapback. Look at the fine print. You have to go to the UN Security Council. What is the likelihood that Putin, Iran's enabler, a surging authoritarian, virulently anti-American Chinese leadership seeking hegemony, not stability, or France, the ally like hemorrhoids, painful to the end. What is the likelihood that any of these countries will not exercise their veto to stymie the provisions lifting the sanctions from being reversed? And apply that to any national security question. If, however, you ask President Obama and he gave an honest answer, his belief is that since the danger to the world is primarily the arrogance of American power, not the threat of our enemies, not rogue regimes in Iran, not Putin seeking to reconstitute some version of a neo-Stalinist empire across East Central Europe, if your worldview is that the greatest threat to American interests is American power itself, then immersing us in international institutions to restrain us makes eminent sense. Now, there are several other corollaries from this foundational premise that the main threat to the world is the arrogance of American power. First of all, President Obama believes that traditional notions of power, that we understand it in international relations theory and practice, focusing on military hard power, economic hard power, these are outmoded, according to Obama and the first mate on his foreign policy Titanic, Mrs. Clinton. According to Obama and advocates of smart power, military power is passé. What is important now is the power of American culture. We need to emphasize these things. And as a corollary to that, Obama's two major national security statements, one issued in 2010, the other reissued in 2015, reiterating the first one's main points, no longer consider that the major issues in international politics, as we have in the past, is how do we deal with potentially dangerous threats in vital geopolitical regions. We no longer focus on potential hegemons dangerous to us and our allies. You read his national security statements. It's what's not there that's astounding. There's no reference in his discussion of East Asia to the rising, surging power of an authoritarian China operating on the strictures of document number nine, Li Peng's statement that freedom is something the Chinese view as an existential threat, and therefore their goal is to push it back and establish hegemony. That's not the threat, according to Obama. The main threat in East Asia, which we should all be worried about, is global warming. Nothing about China. If you look at Obama's national security statement on Europe, again, what's striking is what's not there. What's not there is any reference to Putin's hegemonic ambitions. And honestly, you don't have to be Clausewitz to figure them out. Putin has told us in 2005, speaking to his legislature. So this is not a clandestine statement. This is a disputed statement. Putin said, the greatest tragedy in the 20th century in Russian history was the demise of the Soviet Union. That existential threat to freedom that gave us the gulag, and according to the Black Book of Communism, is directly or indirectly responsible for murdering 100 million people. You don't have to be a strategic genius to understand that resetting relations with an entity like that is going to be a feckless proposition. Or to put it in context, imagine if Angela Merkel had said in 2005, or this morning we read in the press, that the German chancellor said, you know, it's the end of May, we're moving into June, I'm feeling a sense of loss. The greatest tragedy of the 20th century was that sad day in May 9th, where the Third Reich surrendered and was no more. What would we say about Merkel's Germany? We would say this is not a reasonable partner for peace, but a dangerous regime that's going to require unremitting vigilance. But if you're President Obama and you believe that that's not the threat, but it's the United States in general and his benighted predecessor George Bush, who was responsible for all the evils of the world, then resetting relations makes sense. President Obama, one of my chapters situates President Obama's foreign policy in international relations theory. Alas, President Obama achieves the dubious honor of combining the worst features of two very flawed international relations paradigms. One, he accepts the neorealist view that the nature of regimes, the internal characteristics of regimes, whether you're dealing with a decent democracy or a dictatorship animated by a malevolent ideology, that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that a regime is decent and democratic. Indeed, if it's a traditional ally of the United States and the problem is the United States, Obama wants to put distance between the United States and our traditional democratic friends. This is a systematic pattern, starting in Europe. He has denied the special relationship with Great Britain that Churchill and Franklin Roosevelt forged, foundational to American foreign policy in a bipartisan way since Obama. During his negotiations, for example, with this ill-advised treaty with Russia, the START treaty, that forces us to build down and allows them to build up and places restrictions on our ability to develop missile defense, making us more vulnerable not only to Putin, China's burgeoning capability, but Iranian ballistic missiles that are in the process of being developed. We compromise British intelligence and British missile information in an effort to placate Putin. One of the emblematic first and disastrous decisions that Obama made in this regard, again in an effort to conciliate Putin, was his ill-advised decision to cancel the deployment of missile defense in Poland, Hungary, and the Czech Republic in 2009. On the theory that, quote unquote, missile defense was destabilizing, provocative, and by these gestures of unilateral conciliation, we would make Putin a partner for peace in Europe, and Putin would facilitate tranquility rather than foment strife in the Middle East, taming the ambitions, theoretically, of his Iranian and Syrian patrons. We've seen how that has worked out. Obama has made courting China a priority while neglecting relations with a decent democratic India under a prime minister whose view of the world is very consistent with American national interest and morals, rightly understood. Narendra Modi understands the threat of China. He's a capitalist. He also understands the threat of radical Islam. And therefore, since he's a potential ally, Obama has neglected him. And the Japanese, a decent democratic regime, also have a shared interest in constraining the new and dangerous trend in Chinese politics, underwritten by a massive Chinese military buildup that has compromised our ability to defend the allies in the Pacific, because that buildup has coincided with Obama's improvident build-down. He's neglected the Japanese, except for one thing, which is emblematic of Obama's view of the United States. In his trip to East Asia, Obama could not pass up the opportunity on Memorial Day. Putting two fingers in the eyes of America's greatest generation, Obama could not pass up the opportunity to lecture us, almost to the point of apologizing. Certainly that was the implication of it. We're sorry that we dropped the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. This is historically and morally nonsense on stilts. I'm sorry we had to be in the position where that was the lesser evil. But having a father who was going to be 18 in 1946 and ended up in the Marines in Korea and would have been on those landing crafts to the Japanese home islands, and an uncle who fought at Bastogne, who was slated to go to the Pacific, I wouldn't be here, odds are, if Harry Truman didn't make that courageous decision that not only saved plausibly a million American casualties, if you extrapolated the casualty rates for how the Japanese fought fanatically to the death on Iwo Jima and Okinawa, it probably saved 10 million Japanese lives. And in case Obama didn't know it, the Japanese didn't surrender after the first bomb, it took the second. And by the way, as Ronald Spector points out in his fine book, The Eagle Against the Sun, even after the emperor decided to surrender, there was a virulent entity in Japanese politics. There was literally a gunfight in the imperial palace as junior echelon officers, the Al-Qaeda of their day, tried to override that decision. And this is emblematic of President Obama's underlying belief that you can engage your enemies while putting distance between America and its democratic friends. You see this with China, you see this with Putin, you see this with Castro. All of this operates with another underlying premise. Obama is what's called in international relations literature, he's a declinist, meaning he believes that America's best days as a superpower lay behind us. Now, this is also true of Nixon, Kissinger, and Carter in the 70s, and more similar to Carter than Nixon. At least Nixon and Kissinger lamented their unduly pessimistic view that Ronald Reagan rightly repudiated, that we were in decline. Obama has taken this declinist argument to a new and dangerous level, not just in terms of the inevitability of it, which is very disputable. Joe Joffe and Charles Krauthammer are right. Decline is not inevitable, it's a choice. And we are choosing it, dangerously choosing it. Obama actually believes that the emergence of a multipolar world with a diminished American power base and a diminished American role in the world and a diminished American military capability underwriting it, it's not only an inevitable thing, but it's a good thing. So witness what Obama has done to the American defense budget, which has feasted these gathering dangers of which we're just beginning to reap the whirlwind on steroids. If Obama has his way, we are going to have a Navy of 220 surface ships to deal with the major anti-ship, anti-access capability that the Chinese are assiduously pursuing to dominate the Pacific. 220, that's fewer surface ships than we had in 1916 on the eve of World War I, isolationists woefully unprepared for what was to come. If Obama has his way, we're going to have an army smaller than January 1940, woefully unprepared for what was to come. If Obama has his way, the GDP we're spending on defense, which is a little over 3% of the GDP, is going to fall to under 3% of the GDP, less than what we were spending on the eve of Pearl Harbor, woefully unprepared for what was to come. Now here I will offer some friendly but stern criticism to many Republican budget hawks and those who agreed to the sequester that aided and abetted Obama's systematic campaign to assault the material as well as the moral basis of American power. Yes, we have a budgetary problem, but defense is not the problem. And again, let's go back to Ronald Reagan. When Ronald Reagan was given the choice of balancing the budget at the expense of defense or raising taxes at the expense of economic growth, Reagan said, "You never sacrificed national defense. We can more than afford what it's necessary to maintain the preeminence of American power on which provisional justice anywhere, never perfect justice, depends." It's easy to spend 4 to 5% of the GDP. Consider these figures. Harry Truman spent 13% of the GDP on the national defense. Dwight Eisenhower, 9.1% in aggregate. Take liberal John Kennedy in 1961, 52 cents out of every federal dollar, 8.6% of the GDP went to national defense. Take Ronald Reagan, 6.6% of the GDP, 29% of every federal dollar went to national defense. Under President Obama, we're at only 3.1% of the GDP and 15% of every federal dollar on national defense, and we're heading to only 13 cents on every federal dollar on national defense. National defense is not the problem. American weakness will hurt rather than help not only America's security, but its economic well-being. If you want to look at the source of America's budget problems and sclerotic growth that menace the resource base on which American power depends, look to President Obama's domestic initiatives that are intended to transform the United States into some version of a European social democracy, what Erwin Seltzer sardonically but accurately described in the Weekly Standard as government omnipotence at home and impotence internationally abroad. And finally, in his admiring love letter to President Obama published early in his administration by David Remnick of The New Yorker, called The Bridge. We're reading it. You thought you were interrupting an intimate moment. Remnick described Obama's exalted self-definition of himself as a bridge reconciling the races in America. Obama believes that just as much about the world. In fact, I will make a prediction that will probably confirm why it's foolish for professors to make predictions and why you should disregard any of them. I make a prediction that Obama's next job is going to be Secretary General of the United Nations, because that's the only job, in his view, capacious enough for him to be a world citizen. And his goal, which will be aided and abetted by every American enemy from here to Timbuktu, is to enhance the power of the United Nations, primarily to constrain the United States, in the view that Obama believes we're the problem. So think of what he does with adversaries. When in doubt, it's better to be an American enemy than an American friend. Let's take the Middle East, where Obama has made an obsession of trying to appease a virulently anti-Semitic, anti-American, hegemonic Iran bent on crossing the nuclear threshold. And we've signed a treaty with Iran that basically not only does that, but even worse, tranquilizes us to the danger. Now, understand what the implications of that will be. We will have, because of that treaty, it's more likely, a nuclear arms race in the most dangerous, unstable region of the world, because the Saudis, the Egyptians, the Turks, anybody else witnessing Iran crossing the nuclear threshold will not believe, like President Obama, that this is the equivalent of flipping China in the 1970s, the analogy that he often invokes. And Henry Kissinger, who was part of that flip, dismisses. Look at the reset with Putin. How has that turned out? In defiance of all evidence, President Obama has continued to pursue the reset. Now, I wasn't for the reset in the first place. But you could make a case for Obama's in 2009 saying, look, the United States seems to be unpopular in the world. Let's try something else. And this is Obama's theme. Indeed, there is a speech of his, an interview of his, that is little quoted but very revealing, that he gave while he was preparing for the primaries in 2008. It's November 2007, tiny radio station in New Hampshire Public Radio. And Obama said to New Hampshire Public Radio's interviewer, when I become president, our relationship with the Islamic world will improve immediately because I uniquely understand the view of the world. And as part of this engaging with adversaries, Obama, unlike Ronald Reagan, who took regime type and ideology seriously, not only doesn't take those variables seriously, but won't even mention them. And the emblematic expression of that is Obama's neuralgic aversion even to mention the danger of Islamic fascism, much less accept the basis of the danger that should be manifest to anybody with a scintilla of strategic strategy, clarity. Start with this, emblematic of the Obama administration. When in the spring of 2009 at Fort Hood, Texas, Major Assan went on a murderous shooting spree, killing 15, wounding 48, shouting Allah Abu Akbar in Arabic. Stupid people that weren't sophisticated and weren't world citizens and didn't have the audacity of hope believed, based on the theory, if it walks, talks, and quacks like a duck, maybe it is, gee, this is an Islamist attack on us. No, no, we're too sophisticated for that in the Obama administration. If you read the Defense Department's classification of that attack at Fort Hood, it's described as workplace violence, not Islamism. In my view, and there are many very disturbing aspects to the Benghazi episode, the thing that disturbs me most and I think is most emblematic of the Obama administration is that they actually believed what they said. And what they said was, and consider the circumstances that makes this so stunning and illustrates how deeply Obama holds this conviction and how impervious he is to the evidence. It's the anniversary of September 11th. It's an American embassy in Libya. So you don't have to be, again, a strategic genius to say, gee, if there's an attack on the American embassy, maybe the perpetrators are trying to make a statement about September 11th and being part of that. Again, blame America first. Part of Obama's apology tour that began in Ankara, Turkey, in his first trip abroad, reached an apotheosis in Cairo, and has never stopped. And we've had the most recent iteration in Japan discussing Hiroshima. The Obama administration's explanation initially, which I believe they believed. I would have been more reassured if they were lying. But I believe they believed it, is that a Coptic Christian whose community was being murdered and tormented and in anguish. And Obama used the IRS to repress this guy and put him in jail even after the fact, and even after the claim that this was the prompting for the attack proved spurious. The Obama people blamed that Christian, groaning for his religious liberty and in anguish about the death and repression of his community, rather than blame the obvious culprit. So in the Middle East, instead of supporting a decent democratic Netanyahu surrounded by enemies and telling us what we didn't want to hear but needed to know about the Iranian regime, Obama has treated Netanyahu shabbily while courting the Iranian regime. He's treated our Eastern European allies with disregard. If you go around the world, this is the second part, if you actually laid out what he thinks, let's now look at the major reasons of the world and ask the Ronald Reagan question. Are we better off than we were 8 years ago when Obama took office and systematically applied this view of blaming America first, diminishing American power, immersing us in multinational institutions, and engaging adversaries and distancing ourselves from democratic friends? Are we better off? Let's take the reset with Putin that reached its ignominious apotheosis when Obama in 2012 whispered to Putin's stooge Medvedev, whom we actually took seriously as an independent leader, President Obama whispered, "Tell Vladimir, my friend, be patient. Once I don't have to deal with Mitt Romney and Romney warning that this is a danger, I can be much more forthcoming." Putin's invasion of Ukraine should have demolished forevermore any plausibility of the reset being valid that you could propitiate rather than vigilantly deter Putin. Understand how crucial Ukraine is. In many ways, Russia is a basket case. Elon Berman and Garry Kasparov make that case very well, but that makes them even more dangerous. Their economy is in shambles. It's been propped up artificially by energy. Now that the price has fallen, the full weakness of Putin's authoritarian kleptocratic regime is apparent. Siberia, where the resources are depopulating, Russia is having a demographic crisis. The population, according to Nick Eberstadt, will shrink to under 100 million due to a combination of immigration, alcoholism. It's a basket case. But if you add 48 million Ukrainians and those resources and that geography to the Russian Imperium, this makes plausible what would be unplausible otherwise. Putin rolling the dice, exploiting a weak hand as Hitler did in the 30s with his diaspora, bluffing his way to dominance across Central Europe. We have aided and abetted that by our weakness. Instead of arming Ukraine with defensive weapons, we've denied them arms, making multilateralism held hostage to the lowest common denominator of the weakest member the priority rather than what Donald Rumsfeld rightly said should be the priority, developing coalitions of the willing, consistent with a definitive, effective mission rather than subordinating the mission to the coalition and the weakest link in the consensus. We haven't imposed any significant sanctions. The real sanctions, the sanctions that would bite, we've recoiled from on the banking sector and on energy. We haven't reversed the decision on missile defense. We haven't made serious deployments of American forces in the Eastern European members of NATO, particularly Poland and the Baltic. In other words, everything Putin has experienced in Europe since Obama became president would convince someone inclined in that direction anyway that he has literally the green light to expand. Look at East Asia, where China, the Defense Department, released its annual report on Chinese behavior. that should confirm to any fair-minded person that those who are alarmed about China, like Michael Pillsbury in his superb 100-year marathon and Aaron Friedberg, are right. China seeks hegemony, and Chinese hegemony is intimately linked to the growing authoritarianism at home, and that China requires robust deterrence. And by the way, for those of you who think China is inevitably number one, Joe Joffe and others, I think, make a much more persuasive case, Gordon Chang. That's absolutely wrong. The greatest danger is China is destined to reach a Gorbachev moment. Inevitably, Arthur Waldron makes this case eloquently and has for decades. You cannot combine the monopoly of the Communist Party with economic dynamism. The problem is that when China reaches that crisis point, and there are signs that we're within hailing distance of it, one of the critical variables for how the Chinese will respond will be whether China faces a robust deterrent the way Gorbachev faced Reagan, or whether China faces a weak, divided United States the way the Imperial Japanese and other empires rolled the dice in 1941. President Obama's hollow Asia pivot, where we're pivoting with less and substituting rhetoric for materials necessary to bolster our allies, has lowered the barriers of aggression to East Asia, the most important geopolitical region for the world in the 21st century. And if you look at the Middle East, it is a complement that reflects the inflation rate of the Weimar currency of the 20s to say that Obama's policy is in shambles. Everything he has done is wrong. He's King Midas, but it has not turned to gold. I will leave to you, to your imagination, what it's turned to. Let's take Iraq. By making withdrawal rather than victory the priority, he has made everything worse. Now, I am a longtime member of the Witness Protection Program for having written a book to defend the Bush Doctrine before the surge, which got me into the White House, but there weren't many people who wanted to go. So it was like being the best-looking person in the physics department. It was a distinction, but not a great one. Whatever you think of the war of Iraq, we had won it. And if you don't agree with me and say I have an axe to grind, don't take my word for it. Joe Biden said in 2010, this is a great success for American foreign policy. Whether it's 1919 leaving Europe too soon when you made the world not safe for democracy, but for Hitler, Stalin, Mussolini, and Tojo, or leaving Iraq prematurely, American withdrawal will create a power vacuum that rogue regimes will exploit. That's what happened in Iraq, and it also facilitated the rise of ISIS, because the chaos in Iraq that the precipitous withdrawal of American power created allowed the Iranians to use Iraq as an autobahn to promote a sectarian civil war that has metastasized into a geopolitical catastrophe. We don't have to go into the shambles of Libya after we quote unquote led from behind. With regard to Iraq, leaving early also facilitated the rise of ISIS. And again, Obama slept. In 2014, when he was asked about the threat of ISIS, Obama assured us, don't worry, ISIS is merely the JV team, I'm quoting, to the Los Angeles Lakers. Don't worry about it. And if you want the emblematic, besides the Iranian treaty, essence of the Obama Doctrine, think of how the Obama people mishandled Syria and the dangerous repercussions of that, not only that we're still feeling, not only for Syria, but for the world, because the Chinese and Putin drew appropriate lessons that there were no barriers to their expansionist ambition. First, Obama said, there's a red line. And then when Assad, whom Hillary Clinton and John Kerry previously described as a reformer, when Assad crossed that red line, John Kerry, Obama's Pancho Sanza, who has the backbone of a chocolate eclair that's been microwaved on high for 10 minutes, John Kerry off the yacht in Nantucket said, oh my, about that red line. I'm quoting Kerry. If we respond, Kerry said, reassuring Assad, it will be quote unquote pinprick attacks that are unbelievably small. By the time Kerry finished qualifying what we're going to do, you would have thought that we were going to provide the Syrian regime with luxury buses to sit out the inconvenience of this attack on Mediterranean resort hotels. And in the end, Obama, who lambasted George W. Bush for years, saying unilateralism, dangerous. Well, you know what? That George W. Bush got 42 people to sign on to his coalition in Iraq. Meanwhile, Obama, for his enterprise in Syria, that never came off because Congress rightly wouldn't approve it because they knew it got the worst of all possible worlds, too ineffective to work, but too provocative to escape the blame, Obama managed to get one country to sign on to his Syrian initiative, France. When France is your ally in a military endeavor in a region like this, historically that's not a very good sign. It's no accident that after the Syrian debacle that eroded American credibility, Putin almost immediately started his campaign to dismember Ukraine. It's not an accident that immediately after the Syrian debacle, China accelerated their brazen campaign to claim territorial seas and what Roderick Haddock calls their dangerous salami slicing strategy, aimed ultimately to accrete gains over time to dominate the Western Pacific to the detriment of America and our allies in East Asia. So what's the remedy for all this? Let me start with Demosthenes, who was the Winston Churchill of his day. In ancient Greek, when you didn't like a politician for telling you what you needed to hear, but you didn't want to know, you ostracized them, you banished them for 10 years. And Demosthenes warned that the rogue regime of the day, Philip of Macedon, you can't reset relations. You have to deter, and if necessary, fight them, because using force sooner will save, to paraphrase Churchill, much blood, toil, tears, and sweat later. When appeasement failed, and it obviously did, and it always does when you try to appease rogue regimes, whether it's Nazi Germany, the Soviet Union, Iran, they brought Demosthenes back and they said, give us some advice, what do we do? And Demosthenes says, here's my first piece of advice, the foundational piece of advice. Don't do what you're doing now. And for Obama's foreign policy, we need to do the opposite. So what is that? It's what I call neo-Reaganism, which starts from the premise that the United States must remain the world's preeminent military power to preserve some semblance of order in the world's most important geopolitical regions. We must remain the default power. We must embrace rather than reject American exceptionalism. And we must distinguish our democratic friends favorably from our repressive foes in identifying threats, opportunities, and other variables for American foreign policy. That's what we have to do. Unfortunately, unless there's a metamorphosis, and I hope there is, I pray that I see from Donald Trump what I saw with his more reassuring response listing his Supreme Court prospective nominees. It's very disturbing to me that Donald Trump calls himself in a 42-page transcript recounting his interview with the editors of the Washington Post, calls himself an America Firster, that's Lindbergh, who says NATO should go away, and that I quote, we derive no benefit from our alliances with Japan and Korea. This is dangerous. I know the Europeans are frustrating, but if you look at the history of Europe since the 20th century, it is absolutely delusional to think that Europe without the United States can balance effectively against any threat, including Kaiser Wilhelm, Hitler, the Soviet Union in various configurations, or if they can do so with regard to Putin and radical Islam today, it's dangerously concealed from me. Same goes for East Asia, where we have better allies with better inclinations, but India and Japan, even together, needs the United States to underwrite a democratic alliance system to deter China. And finally, in the Middle East, there's no substitute for American power. So in the short term, at least, let's pray that Winston Churchill's right. The United States always does the right thing after we try everything else. Thanks for your forbearance.
We have a few minutes for questions.
Yes, sir. And then I'll.
Dan Pop of the Zionist Organization of America. Thanks, it's a great talk. In blaming Obama for this foreign policy, let's not forget that he was elected and reelected. What role did the American people have and the isolationist strain we've always had, which was kept submerged by great leadership in the 40s and 50s, appears to have resurfaced, and as you mentioned, even in the Republican Party.
I think that if the United American people are not, look, this is an angry year, and the anger is understandable. The Bernie Sanders candidacy is fueled by anger and scapegoating, so is Donald Trump's. And there's a lot to be angry about, but the expression of anger is irrational. Now, on the Democratic side, if you look at Pew Foundation polls, Obama is both a catalyst and a driver of this Democratic move to the left that was briefly interrupted in the interregnum of, let's say, 1992 to 2000, that reached its apotheosis when someone like Joe Lieberman, my next book project, could be the vice presidential candidate. Iraq did to the Democratic Party what Vietnam did in the 60s. It brought out what I call this Henry Wallace recessive gene and made it dominant. What's really dangerous is not just that the Democrats have committed moral and intellectual suicide in international relations, but there's a danger that the Republican Party might do it. When I wrote the book, I thought the greater danger was Rand Paul reviving some version of America First, and I would have been very troubled by him being the presidential candidate. I misidentified Paul as the primary threat, but I did identify that there is now, the Republican Party is now a contested party. Not conservatives in it, because conservatives didn't vote for Trump, but the Republican Party no longer is a conservative party that we can take for granted as we have understood it since Ronald Reagan. And we're going to have to fight for that tradition, and it is going to be very dangerous for the United States if not just the Democratic Party, but the Republican Party retreats into 19th century politics in a 21st century world. And while the objectives, there's no reason for American decline being inevitable. If I were writing a history of the last 8 years in this election cycle, I think someday someone's going to call it, and I think we'll fail, America's suicide attempt. And let's hope Bismarck's right. God protects three categories of people: fools, drunkards, and the United States. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
But for Asian engagement and the containment of China, mm-hmm. the TPP is seen by many as a is a critical multilateral agreement that will safeguard America's economic and strategic future in Asia. What's your opinion?
I'm happy with that agreement, but the idea that these economic agreements can suffice, or that global warming is the threat, we need to rebuild the American military and make credible our commitments to Japan, Korea, and I hope India as an emerging ally, to convince the Chinese that there is no the good news about the Chinese is the bad news. The Chinese are much more sophisticated about pursuing their long-term strategy, and they are deterrable if they confront a robust deterrent. They're like the Soviet Union in that respect. What I fear is that if you neglect what's happening in China internally, it's linked to how they define their external aims and how the variable of American weakness versus American strength will affect their calculations. We almost are moving to the perfect storm of China moving to crisis, but seeing an opportunity the way the Japanese in the 1920s took advantage of the chaos in Manchuria to expand rather than reform. I want an architecture in place so that when China reaches this reckoning and the Chinese leadership calculates, they answer in Russian, "Niet, not today." We're facing a Reagan-esque United States resurgent, materially strong, conceptually clear about what our interests are, rather than a regime in Washington that is dismantling American power, doesn't understand who our friends are, and does not really recognize that we have enemies and who they are. So I'm not against that pact, but I think the idea that economics or cultural exchange can substitute for robust military deterrence with the United States leading it. Your country also worries that if the United States does not provide that deterrence, Australia is in a very dangerous neighborhood, which is why the ANZUS Pact and our alliance with Japan, and I hope some arrangement with India, remain for the 21st century even more important than Europe, given Asia's geostrategic importance. So I agree that pact is good, but it's not sufficient. And to quote the old Shangri-La song, we got to be leader of the pack. With those, that motorcycle exhaust underscoring it.
Okay, one more question.
You talked about culture and how smart power advocates wanted to focus on American cultural benefits, and you also indicated that there was a decline of conservatism as an effective counter to what the Democrats are.
Or Reaganite conservatism.
Yes, and so given that. And Thomas Sowell often speaks about reaching a point of no return for the country. Given that I believe, like you, that it's going to take a Reagan-type leader to reinvigorate and do what you want to do, and the fact that I don't see any on the horizon, at least not right now, how sanguine are you that we're going to be able to rise to the challenge?
Well, both Judeo-Christian religious principles and Winston Churchill tell you, never despair. Pessimism and declinism are an excuse for taking responsibility for what we can do. We faced bad situations before. The world didn't look very good in 1941. Didn't look good in the 30s. If you lived through the 70s and the Carter years and that debacle in the desert, where you sent enough helicopters to be visible, but not enough to succeed, and Carter getting up there, describing it as an incomplete success on the eve of the New Hampshire primary, and the malaise speech, and walking with the sweater, and humble, and groveling, and Nixon and Kissinger saying, we're Athens to Sparta. You wouldn't be very optimistic about that either, and people thought Reagan was a nut for saying that our best days were ahead of us. So the idea that it's all over, history is not inevitable. This historicist fallacy that history is an independent force, we make it. So whether we succeed or fail, like Abraham Lincoln in 1860, which didn't look like a good year either, it's going to depend on what we do and don't do. And it's very dangerous to abnegate your responsibility by saying, oh, it's just so hopeless. I'm going to be Jeremiah's remnant and just sit this one out and say, you all deserve this. Keep fighting. Keep fighting as Churchill did, or the Scoop Jacksons and Reagan did in the 70s. So to quote Bob Dylan, the loser now is later to win, for the times they are changing, so that the American people have a genuine choice, not an echo, when circumstances sooner or later will tell you that we have to go back to what made us great in the first place and we can't continue this. You want to be ready for that moment rather than sulking in despair or going along like Vichy Republicans, so that the American people have a choice, not an echo.
I promise you we're going to have Bob back, and the next time we're going to ask him not to beat around the bush and just say what's on his mind.
Thanks, Bob. Great job.